There is nothing wrong with fun, with worship. We're going to start with a song that everyone has to participate in, okay?
Father Abraham?
No, Hallelujah, Adonai. But that's a good one. I like that one. You've been with the kids, huh?
I used to the whole congregation.
Yeah. I've done that. I've done that with a lot of songs. But this is called Hallelujah, Adonai. And it says praise him with the cymbals, praise him with the dance, praise him with the shofar, praise him with the timbrel, praise him with the harp, the drum, and the flute. Now, we don't have a harp, and we don't have a I do have a flute in there somewhere. Someone actually knows how to play it, I'll get it out, but it's like a penny whistle type flute. I don't even know what key it's in. It's a single key flute. But
if it's a penny whistle, it's a D.
What?
If it's a penny whistle, it's a D.
Oh. I just know that I got it from, anyway. I don't know. So anyway, there are timbrels up there. There are maracas. There are little tambourines. There are flags. We don't have any little bongos. We need to get some of those. That's my next purchase for instrumentation is some bongos. So we have drums.
You can get a bongo bongo box at McDonald's.
No. But everyone needs an instrument, or if you can't find another instrument, you can clap your hands, okay?
I'm going to use me.
You're going to use, you can use your body. Our bodies are instruments to the Lord. And Janie's not been well this week, but she's going to try to do the dancing.
If I end up on the floor and I get to leave this earth, do not bring me back.
The power is not within me.
Oh, but it is.
Yes, it is. The same power
that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is in me.
I stand corrected.
Scripture says the power is there, however. I know the feeling. Raise him with the cymbals. Praise him.
Praise him with the drum and the flute. Praise him with your heart. Hallelujah.
Chernoff, and I've been looking for some of his music that we could actually do, because some of his music is not easy. And I'm still working on that one. Mija Moja.
Oh,
Sister Pat, and love of God, you're an awesome cup. That he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. His great name, now we know his Hebrew name is Yeshua, and I believe it's to that name we will bow. Yeshua HaMashiach. It's what his mother called him, Yeshua.
You don't think she called him Yeshu?
She might have called him Yeshu. She might have, because that is a nickname for Yeshua. Yeshua means salvation. Amen. So when we say the name Yeshua, we are declaring salvation. Your great name. Lost or saved, find their way at the sound. great name. The sick are healed, and the dead are raised, at the sound of your great name, Yeshua. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, Son of God. In Revelation, it says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Okay, so we plead the blood over us, but we also need to declare the testimonies. And I just feel like right now there's got to be a testimony or two. I know in my case, there was one time I was driving down to California with a friend of mine, and it was really kind of one of those things where I was obnoxious and I wanted to drive my car. You know, you ever been that way? I'm a control freak sometimes. And in that case, I was being a control freak. I wanted to have my car. I wanted to be able to exit, to leave if I needed to, where we were going. And we were going with a whole group, and I could have ridden in the van, but I wanted my car. So one friend went with me, and we got down to Weed, and we're getting off the highway to get some coffee at the McDonald's in Weed. I don't know if you've ever been there, but it's kind of a sharp turn. Well, it had been snowing. Not only had it been snowing, but it had been snowing, you know? One of those days where the snow was covering the ice that was underneath that I didn't know was there. And as I go off the freeway, the car did, instead of just turning onto the thing, it just kept turning. Have you ever had that happen? Turning, and about the third time it went around, we both yelled out, "Jesus," and it stopped. And I was like, "Thank you." Because, you know, it's not fun when the car turns around any more than when the room turns around like was happening last week. But I know that sometimes when we cry out his name, in that moment is when he does something. And I think there's someone else with that kind of a testimony today that needs to share it right now.
I was just thinking about before I was a believer. And the Lord had been calling me since I was a kid, but I was running away from God for years and got heavy duty in the occult, sometimes so heavy duty that, I mean, I was surrounded with evil and spirits and stuff trying to destroy me. And I'll never forget, and I didn't get saved on that day, but there was this time I got attacked. I'd be lifted out of my bed and trying to be thrown around the room there, and I cried out, "Jesus, help me!" and stopped. And at that point, I think I probably should have gotten saved, but I still was rebellious at that time. And I said, "Thanks, Lord!
Thank you!"
But calling on his name, he is there for you. And the time that I did get saved, when I cried out to the Lord, I cried out to him and asked him for forgiveness. He was there just like that, even though all the stuff that I'd ever done against him and had cursed his name, and he still loved me enough and saved me on that day. And so it's a powerful name, and he loves us very much, and he knows where we're at. Mm-hmm. And he changed my life at that point and brought me to here. So.
And I love that he does that for us. He does that for us. Why? Because he loves us, right? And we don't know his Hebrew name, you know, and I've had people to get upset with me over this, okay? But I don't think God gets any more upset over us calling him Jesus than we get upset over our grandkids calling us by wrong names. We had a son, a grandson, Jacob. Jacob had his own language. I don't know if you've ever known a child that does that or not. But by the time he was two, he was speaking fluently. Just nobody understood a word he said. And it was a language. And the way I know it was a language is certain things had certain names. Paka, Bunga. He was Paka, I'm Bunga. Now, we don't know where he came up with that. But do you think we ever corrected him? If he came running to us and yelling, Bunga, it's like, hug, grab that kid, hug him. I don't care what he calls me. Because he loves me and I love him. And there's a place where God knows from our hearts who we're crying out to. And if I call him Jesus, he hears me. If I call him Yeshu, he hears me. If I call him Jesus, he hears me. If we call him Yeshua, he hears us. He is the worthy lamb slain, and he is the one who answers our prayers. No matter what name we call him.
And no matter where you are. Because he responds to the sinner just as he responds to the saint.
And that's an absolutely positive thing that we don't always understand. He does respond to the sinner as much as he responds to the saint. And in fact, sometimes more so. I will tell you, when I walked in disobedience, I cried out his name and their response would be there. And sometimes when I've walked in obedience and I've cried out his name, he says, no, you calm down. You know, there's a silly saying, and it says, sometimes he calms the storm, and sometimes he calms his child. And when we're his children, he will calm us. And even if he wants us to walk through a storm, he will still take care of it, and he will take care of us. So we can't always judge it by whether or not the storm calms down. We have to be willing to let him calm us down, too. Let's go ahead and do the Shema. Begin our prayers. And in the seat in front of you, there's programs that have the words that you can follow along with us. We do the Shema as a responsive reading. Craig will read it in the Hebrew. If you know the Hebrew and you want to read the Hebrew part, feel free to, or just respond with the English. But we do ask to stand for the sound of the shofar, because the sounding of the shofar announces the coming of the king. And we would not stand in the presence, we would not sit in the presence of the king or the queen of England, nor would we sit in the presence of our own president until invited to. We stand out of honor and respect for the king.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Baruch Shem Kevod Malkuto Le'olam Vayed. Blessed be the name of his glorious kingdom forever and ever. Vahafta el Adonai Eloheka b'kor laveka uvkor navshaka uvkor meldecha. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Vahayu hadvarim hayala asher anoki mitzavka hayom ala vaveka. And these words that I command you today shall be in your heart. Vishinantam levenecha vedabarta bam bevshekka bevteka uvleka vererek ukshakbeka uvkameka. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall speak of them when you sit at home, when you walk along the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Ukshaktom leolo ayadeka vahayu letotafot bin inecha. And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be for frontlets between your eyes. Uktavtam al mozozot b'teka uvisharecha. And you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Vehava laraka kamoka. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Brukata Aronai Lachino Meleka Alom, Asher Kirshanu, Bimitzpatab, Bitsivanu Lechiot, Legoim, Benatan Lanu, Yeshua Hamashiach, or Haolam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with your commandments and commanded us to be a light unto the nations, and has given us Yeshua, the Messiah, the light of the world. Father, thank you for the light of the world. Thank you that you have placed that light within us. Thank you that you give to us such a powerful representation of yourself, It's not just who you are, it is you. And I thank you for that. Abba Father, as we gather together today, I ask that you would bless our gathering. As we bless your name, as we bless you, as we bring our requests to you, we ask that you would hear us. Your word says you do. So we acknowledge that and recognize it. And yet we still ask. Thank you for hearing us. Father, today I want especially to bring before you David and Helene as they are driving down to California. They will be, as they fly out on Monday, going to the Philippines to see her father. Lord, I ask your blessing upon them. I ask your peace upon her, as she knows her father has called them because he's in his last hours, his last days. Give her peace. And I know that there's a lot of division in that family based on faith, but you have given Helene and David a strong understanding of your word, a strong faith in you. And I ask that they would be your hands and feet to the rest of the family, in love, in peace, serving joyfully, and yet steadfast. Yeshua is salvation. There is salvation found in no other. And I thank you for that. Give them open doors of witness to her family and keep them safe. Keep them safe. Bring them back to us safe and strong. Thank you for them, Father. I thank you for Helene's heart of service that she gives to us so much. And I'm just asking that you would comfort that heart right now. Right now. In the name of Yeshua.
Father, I want to give you praise and thanks. Before I ask you for anything, I want to declare your works and what you have done. Lord God, you have met us here in this tiny little place that you call a wellspring, that you call a storage house, Lord God. You have met us face to face in this place. You have brought healing to this place. Mm-hmm. You have set up a foundation in this place that cannot be rocked, that cannot be cracked. Lord God, I thank you for that. I thank you, Lord God, that you are building this place up, Lord God. I thank you that you send us out, Lord God, and with the words that you give us, Lord God, your word is accomplished. I thank you, you send us up the mountain, Lord God, and that your word was accomplished. Lord God, you are the God of Klamath Falls in this territory. And I just want to praise you in this place today. That you sent us out from, Lord God, that we give you thanks and we praise you for that work. We praise you, Lord God, for what you did and that you did through us. We thank you, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit is seriously in charge here. Lord God, we thank you for that. And in my prayers, Lord God, I thank you for our guest today. He's no longer a guest. He's our family. Mm-hmm. Mario, you are welcome in this family. We have prayed you in, sir. I want you to know that, and that's the truth. I praise you, Lord God. You are moving. You are moving heavily. We go out and we pray for these streets and we see them getting cleaned up. Lord God, all that needs to be told. All that needs to go forth. That we're just not people going out and doing stuff and nothing's happening. That you, God, are on the move in this place. That you have taken down the idols, Lord God. And that you will continue to take down the idols, Lord God. And Lord God, that we are here for people. We are here for people. Lord God, so send us out. Keep sending us out. Keep bringing them in, Lord God. That we may know you. Because you say all the time, know me in this place. Mm-hmm. So, Lord God, that we may know you in this place. And I thank you for the work. And, Lord God, again, I lift up my own family, Lord God, for salvation. So I speak your name over them today. And I speak your blood over them today. And I speak my testimony over them today. That not one day, but many days and every day, I call on your name and you save me. And there hasn't been a day that you haven't saved me. And I have been down, and I have been down, and you have raised me up every time, Lord God. So I praise you, and I ask you again for my family, that they may walk in this truth with me while I'm still here, Lord God. Not after I'm gone and they look back at it. Bring that fold in. They've been trained, Lord God. So I thank you, and I thank you for every family member in this place. Lord God, that they are covered with your blood and that they have your testimony ready in their mouths, Lord God. Not just for service today, not just for service on a specific day, but every day, Lord God, that we carry your light everywhere we go into this world. And I thank you so much for this church. I love this church. Lord God, I thank you again and I praise your name. Jesus.
And the floor is open if anyone else would like to offer a prayer that we can join in and agree with you on.
Father, we thank you for this awesome day and Lord, for all that you're doing in all of our lives. And Lord, I just want to give thanks to you for bringing Chris back home and to be with us, Lord, and so we can spend time together, Lord, and glorify you. So I just pray that you continue to touch Chris's life and our lives together with him. Father, as we all grow and know you in a greater way, Father. We just thank you for all that you do, for everything in our lives. Mm-hmm. We praise you, we give you glory and honor. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father.
I want to be close to your side, so heaven is real and death is alive. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one. Side. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one.
Historically, there are three times that God has dwelt with his people in an active, very physical form. It's kind of hard to explain the physicalness of the Mishkan, but there was a presence of God that was very much in the physical realm, that was very reachable. We're going to read today a portion of scripture called Teruma, which means a heave offering, okay? And I was always one of those kids, what is a heave offering? Well, basically just means a lifted up, something that has been lifted, an offering that is lifted up. And I'll explain more about that in the teaching, but we're going to read about that which is lifted up to God. It's found, I got to find it again. It's found in Exodus, beginning in chapter 25, verse 1. Through 27, verse 19, and it's all about the building of the Mishkan, the tabernacle, the dwelling place of God.
Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Tell the sons of Israel to raise a contribution for me. From every man whose heart moves him, you shall raise my contribution. This is the contribution which you are to raise from them: gold, silver, and bronze, purple, blue, and scarlet material, fine linen, goat hair, ram skins dyed red, porpoise skins, acacia wood, oil for lighting, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and setting stones for the ephod and for the breastpiece. Let them construct a sanctuary for me, that I may dwell among them, according to all that I am going to show you as the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furniture. Just so you shall construct it. They shall construct an ark of acacia wood, 2.5 cubits long, and 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. You shall overlay it with pure gold. Inside and out you shall overlay it, and you shall make a gold molding around it. You shall cast 4 gold rings for it, and fasten them on its 4 feet, and 2 rings shall be on one side of it, and 2 rings on the other side of it. You shall make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. You shall put the poles into the rings on the sides of the ark and carry the ark with them. The poles shall remain in the rings of the ark. They shall not be removed from it. You shall put into the ark the testimony which I shall give you. You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide. You shall make 2 cherubim of gold. Make them of hammered work at the 2 ends of the mercy seat. Make 1 cherub at 1 end and 1 cherub at the other end. You shall make the cherubim of 1 piece with the mercy seat at its 2 ends. The cherubim shall have their wings spread upward, covering the mercy seat with their wings and facing one another. The faces of the cherubim are to be turned toward the mercy seat. You shall put the mercy seat on top of the ark. And in the ark you shall put the testimony which I will give to you. There I will meet with you, and from above the mercy seat, from between the 2 cherubim which are upon the ark of the testimony, I will speak to you about all that I will give you in commandment for the sons of Israel. You shall make a table of acacia wood, 2 cubits long and 1 cubit wide, and 1.5 cubits high. You shall overlay it with pure gold and make a gold border around it. You shall make for it a rim of a handbreadth around it, and you shall make a gold border for the rim around it. You shall make 4 gold rings for it, and put rings on the 4 corners which are on its 4 feet. The rings shall be close to the rim, as holders for the poles to carry the table. You shall make the poles of acacia wood, and overlay them with gold, so that with them the table may be carried. You shall make its dishes and its pans and its jars and its bowls with which to pour drink offerings. You shall make them of pure gold. You shall set the bread of the presence on the table before me at all times. Then you shall make a lampstand of pure gold. The lampstand and its base and its shaft are to be made of hammered work. Its cups, its bulbs, and its flowers shall be of 1 piece with it. 6 branches shall go out from its sides, 3 branches of the lampstand from its one side, and 3 branches of the lampstand from its other side. 3 cups shall be shaped like almond blossoms in the 1 branch, a bulb and a flower, and three cups shaped like almond blossoms in the other branch, a bulb and a flower. So for six branches going out from the lampstand. And in the lampstand, four cups shaped like almond blossoms, its bulbs and its flowers. A bulb shall be under the first pair of branches coming out of it, and a bulb under the second pair of branches coming out of it, and a bulb under the third pair of branches coming out of it, for the six branches coming out of the lampstand. Their bulbs and their branches shall be of one piece with it. All of it shall be one piece of hammered work of pure gold. Then you shall make its lamps seven in number, and they shall mount its lamps so as to shed light on the space in front of it. Its snuffers and their trays shall be of pure gold. It shall be made from a talent of pure gold with all these utensils. See that you make them after the pattern for them, which was shown to you on the mountain. Moreover, you shall make the tabernacle with 10 curtains of fine twisted linen and blue and purple and scarlet material. You shall make them with cherubim, the work of a skillful workman. The length of each curtain shall be 28 cubits, and the width of each curtain 4 cubits. All the curtains shall have the same measurements. 5 curtains shall be joined to one another, and the other 5 curtains shall be joined to one another. You shall make loops of blue on the edge of the outermost curtains in the first set, and likewise you shall make them on the edge of the curtain that is outermost in the second set. You shall make 50 loops in the one curtain, and you shall make 50 loops on the edge of the curtain that is in the second set. The loops shall be opposite each other. You shall make 50 clasps of gold and join the curtains to one another with the clasps, so that the tabernacle will be a unit. Then you shall make curtains of goat's hair for a tent over the tabernacle. You shall make 11 curtains in all. The length of each curtain shall be 30 cubits, and the width of each curtain 4 cubits. The 11 curtains shall have the same measurements. You shall join 5 curtains by themselves, and the other 6 curtains by themselves, and you shall double over the 6th curtain at the front of the tent. You shall make 50 loops on the edge of the curtain that is outermost in the first set, and 50 loops on the edge of the curtain that is outermost in the second set. You shall make 50 clasps of bronze, and you shall put the clasps into the loops and join the tent together so that it will be a unit. The overlapping part that is left over in the curtains of the tent, the half curtain that is left over, shall lap over the back of the tabernacle. The cubit on one side and the cubit on the other of what is left over in the length of the curtains of the tent shall lap over the sides of the tabernacle on one side and on the other to cover it. You shall make a covering for the tent of ram skins dyed red, and a covering of porpoise skins above. Then you shall make the boards for the tabernacle of acacia wood, standing upright. 10 cubits shall be the length of each board, and 1.5 cubits is the width of each board. There shall be 2 tenons for each board fitted to one another. Thus you shall do for all the boards of the tabernacle. You shall make the boards for the tabernacle, 20 boards for the south side. And you shall make 40 sockets of silver under the 20 boards, 2 sockets under one board for its 2 tenons, and 2 sockets under another board for its 2 tenons. And for the second side of the tabernacle, on the north side, 20 boards, and their 40 sockets of silver, 2 sockets under one board and 2 sockets under another board. For the rear of the tabernacle to the west, you shall make 6 boards. You shall make 2 boards for the corners of the tabernacle at the rear. They shall be doubled beneath, and together they shall be complete to its top to the first ring. Thus it shall be with both of them. They shall form the 2 corners. There shall be 8 boards with their sockets of silver, 16 sockets, 2 sockets under one board and 2 sockets under another board. Then you shall make bars of acacia wood, 5 for the boards of one side of the tabernacle, and 5 bars for the boards of the other side of the tabernacle, and 5 bars for the boards of the side of the tabernacle for the rear side to the west. The middle bar in the center of the boards shall pass through from end to end. You shall overlay the boards with gold and make their rings of gold as holders for the bars, and you shall overlay the bars with gold. Then you shall erect the tabernacle according to its plan which you have been shown in the mountain. You shall make a veil of blue and purple and scarlet material and fine twisted linen. It shall be made with cherubim, the work of a skilled workman. You shall hang it on four pillars of acacia, overlaid with gold, their hooks also being of gold, on four sockets of silver. You shall hang up the veil under the clasps, and shall bring in the ark of the testimony there within the veil, and the veil shall serve for you as a partition between the holy place and the holy of holies. You shall put the mercy seat on the ark of the testimony in the holy of holies. You shall set the table outside the veil and the lampstand opposite the table on the side of the tabernacle toward the south. And you shall put the table on the north side. You shall make a screen for the doorway of the tent of blue and purple and scarlet material, of fine twisted linen, the work of a weaver. You shall make five pillars of acacia for the screen and overlay them with gold, their hooks also being of gold, and you shall cast five sockets of bronze for them. And you shall make the altar of acacia wood, 5 cubits long and 5 cubits wide. The altar shall be square, and its height shall be 3 cubits. You shall make its horns on its four corners. Its horns shall be of one piece with it, and you shall overlay it with bronze. You shall make its pails for removing its ashes, and its shovels, and its basins, and its forks, and its fire pans. You shall make all its utensils of bronze. You shall make for it a grating of a network of bronze, and on the net you shall make four bronze rings at its four corners. You shall put it beneath, under the ledge of the altar, so that the net will reach halfway up the altar. You shall make poles for the altar, poles of acacia wood, and overlay them with bronze. Its poles shall be inserted into the rings, so that the poles shall be on its two sides of the altar when it is carried. You shall make it hollow with planks, as it was shown to you in the mountain, so they shall make it. You shall make the court of the tabernacle. On the south side there shall be hangings for the court of fine twisted linen, 100 cubits long for one side, and its pillars shall be 20, with their 20 sockets of bronze. The hooks of the pillars and their bands shall be of silver. Likewise, for the north side in length there shall be hangings, 100 cubits long, and its 20 pillars with their 20 sockets of bronze. The hooks of the pillars and their bands shall be of silver. For the width of the court on the west side shall be hangings of 50 cubits with their 10 pillars and their 10 sockets. The width of the court on the east side shall be 50 cubits. The hangings for the one side of the gate shall be 15 cubits with their 3 pillars and their 3 sockets. And for the other side shall be hangings of 15 cubits with their 3 pillars and their 3 sockets. For the gate of the court there shall be a screen of 20 cubits of blue and purple and scarlet material, and fine twisted linen, the work of a weaver, with their 4 pillars and their 4 sockets. All the pillars around the court shall be furnished with silver bands, with their hooks of silver and their sockets of bronze. The length of the court shall be 100 cubits, and the width 50 throughout, and the height 5 cubits of fine twisted linen, and their sockets of bronze. All the utensils of the tabernacle used in all its service, and all its pegs, and all the pegs of the court shall be of bronze.
Probably don't know because we haven't done it here very often. But we read about it today. We read about that place that in the translation Craig read, it says mercy seat, the atonement covering, the place of atonement. The place of atonement is the place of our mercy.
During this, it would be all right if anybody needed prayer, then I could pray for them.
You need to say that where everyone can hear you.
If anybody needs specific prayer, now's the time. My hands are burning.
At the mercy seat, at the mercy.
mercy seat. He speaks to me his grace. Hear the heart of my Father's house. There's room enough for you. Hear the heart of my Father's house. You can find his presence.
I'm addicted to it. Thank you, because you are so good. A couple years ago when I was first beginning to understand how God speaks to us individually, not just through the written word, but how he speaks to us through his spirit, I went online and I joined a group in a chat room. How many of you remember those old things called chat rooms? Okay, yeah. Well, I joined a group in a chat room and started practicing hearing the voice of God. Now, in this chat room, of course, in chat rooms, you're supposed to have nicknames, right? You're not supposed to go by your real name. You're supposed to go by a nickname, which kind of bothered me. But, you know, they asked me to come up with a nickname, and I did. Worship Junkie. They didn't like it. Addicted to worship. Because the scripture says he inhabits the praises of his people. And I don't know if you've ever noticed it, but when we forget about ourselves, when we lose that place of whether or not I'm, if personally for me, you know, it's whether or not I'm hitting the keys right or whether or not the notes are coming out. It doesn't matter. It gets to the point where I'm seeing it for him. And it doesn't matter. And if I make a mistake, he doesn't care because he's my daddy and he loves me. And so if you guys hear mistakes, oh well. I've gotten past that point. Because it's not a performance. It's about, God, we are worshiping you. Amen. We're coming into your presence. And when we let go of the performance, something shifts in the atmosphere. Now, I realize that those who believe in Yeshua, those who call on his name, are given the Holy Spirit. I understand that. Each of us has a portion of that Holy Spirit. We each have a Holy Spirit. But there's something about corporate worship that brings in a more tangible presence. Okay? Yes, part of that is just the body of Christ, the body of Messiah getting together and each of us coming and adding our little part. And our, that spirit in me communes with the spirit in you. There's part of that, yes, we are the church. We bring the Spirit of God. But there's also a part where when we worship, that Spirit of God becomes something more than just that little bit that's in me. Although, as we said earlier, you know, the same power is in you that raised Christ from the dead. That's powerful. Sometimes we don't realize how powerful the Spirit of God is in us. Our reading today is talking about what it takes, honestly, to have the presence of God. In a tangible form in the earthly realm. Because that's what the tabernacle was for. The tabernacle was built so that the power and the presence of God could dwell amongst the people of Israel in a physical form without them all dying. Okay? There was a statement, I don't remember which one it was now. I wish I could. Sometimes I read these stories about these rabbis and I forget who said what and who did what. But there was a rabbi that was called in to, was it Alexander the Great? I think it was Alexander the Great, who wanted to know why these Jews were so stubborn in worshiping their God. And he called in the high priest of that time and he said to him, if your God is so good, how come I can't see him? The high priest bowed his head and he said, go out and stare at the sun. Alexander the Great's response was, you can't stare at the sun. It hurts. You can't see God. It hurts. The reality is our God is a consuming fire, much more powerful than the sun that he created and put in the sky. We cannot see him in physical form and not die unless God has set up something specific. And he shows us a portion of himself, just a portion. But the Mishkan, the tabernacle, was designed to be a place where the presence of God, as powerful and as great as that is, could reside among the people of Israel and have them survive it, where they could have a tangible presence. And it wasn't just put this together, put this together, put this together. Very specific instructions God gives. And I want you to notice something. There's a couple places in here it says, see that you make it according to the pattern being shown to you on the mountain. That's the last verse of chapter 25. The pattern shown to you on the mountain. He repeats that phrase, verse 30 of 26. You are to raise up the tabernacle according to the plan that you were shown on the mountain. Now, what that tells me is not everything is written in here. Okay? That makes room for something that we call the oral Torah, where it's handed down orally. It wasn't written down exactly as Moshe saw it. Have you ever tried to give instructions to somebody where you couldn't show it to them physically? You just had to use words?
Yeah.
I've done that. We had an English class once where he actually had us do that. He had someone stand on one side of the blackboard and someone stand on the other side, okay? And the person on this side was to draw a simple figure. And the instruction was a simple figure. Then he was supposed to instruct the person on the other side how to draw that figure without coming around, using only words. It was hilarious to the rest of us, who could kind of see both sides because he had it a little bit angled. So this guy over here, he literally drew a stick figure, you know, the circle on the head and the line straight down and the arms and the legs, right? And then he tried to explain to this guy how to draw it. Okay, you put a circle in the paper. So the guy did. Specific details weren't given necessarily here where we read it. And yet, there's lots of specific detail in here, isn't it? But if you go to a place online called templeinstitute.org and you look at what they've put together in terms of rebuilding the temple, and remaking some of these articles. They are in Jerusalem, and they are preparing for that next temple to be put on Temple Mount. And you know what, guys? They've got everything ready, actually. They have everything ready. They even have a stone altar that can be moved in and a sacrifice set up just like that. The only thing they don't have right now is the red heifer. And why the red heifer? Because without the red heifer, you cannot have the waters of cleansing. And without the waters of cleansing, the high priest cannot do his work. Sacrifice can't be made without the waters of cleansing. The water of cleansing comes from the sacrifice of a red heifer. Okay, that's how come we had cow pictures up for a while. Because we were learning about the red heifer. I say that because people have come in and they look at some of the stuff we have up and they go, what's with the cow picture? They're in the men's bathroom right now. But there was a season we were learning about that, and we were learning about that promise, and that a visual helps us, doesn't it? It helps me anyway. Maybe I'm just a kindergartner, but, you know, visuals help. But they are building all of these pieces that are described in here. Except they haven't built the outside. But they've built an altar, a stone altar. That's prepared. They've built a menorah, hammered work, according to the instructions, not just here, but according to what they understand from the oral tradition that did get written down eventually in terms of the mission of the Talmud and all of that. Okay, so they have done that. Now, the table of showbread, and I got to tell you something. I've looked at some of their stuff, and I've gone, it does not look like anything I would have envisioned from what I read in here until I go and look at some of the more detailed stuff, and I go, oh, maybe they know more than I do. Did you ever think about that? I mean, we have up here a kind of a representation. That's part of what's up here. Part of why we have it the way we have it. We have an altar here. Because you see, without the sacrifice in the temple, the Shabbat table becomes that altar of prayer in every home. So we have an altar of prayer right here. We have a menorah. We have a little thing over there with shelves on it that's designed to kind of be like the table of showbread, okay? That's what it's supposed to represent. Now, I know it doesn't look anything like it. It really doesn't. We have an ark up there. Our ark has a Torah scroll in it. It's a student scroll, but it's still a Torah scroll, okay? It's handmade of wood. But we didn't overlay it with gold. Why? Because we are not the temple in Jerusalem. We are not the tabernacle. But we want to understand it. We want to learn about it. But we don't want to represent it in such a way that someone could go on Ben and say, oh, well, they think they're replacing it. Because we're not. We're not. But in all of that, when God wants to make his presence among people, he is specific about how to do it. He was very specific here. Someone, you know, some people have told me, you get really caught up in details. Yeah, well, I think God did too. He's very detailed in the instruction. And even the stuff that get left out here was given through the oral Torah. And they've got an entire book in the Mishnah called Teruma, specifically about the offerings that are lifted up. Okay? And there's a whole lot of stuff you can learn from it. That a little bit of it I'm going to mention, but not much. Because I still am beginning. I'm a beginner. I'm like in kindergarten with understanding some of this stuff. But there's enough at that level to feed us for a long time. But as we learn, it goes more. I already mentioned the word teruma, which is at the very beginning, means to lift up. It says, Adonai spoke to Moshe, saying, tell B'nai Israel to take up an offering for me. Okay? From anyone whose heart compels him, you are to take my offering. And these are the contributions which you are to receive from them. Or in another translation, these are the offerings that you are to receive from them. There's three times the word offerings is given here. Or three times that word is used. Kind of an interesting concept. Three different times. It means uplifting. We're supposed to offer it up to him. And it says here, from every man whose heart moves him. Okay? Tell him to take up an offering from anyone whose heart moves him. That means any willing heart. That means you're not supposed to browbeat the people. You don't get up there and say, if you don't give this amount of money, then God will not bless you. You're not supposed to do that. Sorry. It says here, a willing heart. If I'm going to build the house of God, I cannot go to you and say, well, I need to be nice now. There was a radio preacher several years ago who made the statement on the radio that if I don't raise the money to build this tower of prayer to the Lord, God will strike me dead. I will not survive. I will be dead if we don't raise that money. So you guys need to send in the money so I can live and build this tower. There was a millionaire that heard him say that thought it was hilarious, and he just finally gave him the rest of the money. Yeah, I like the rest of your teaching. That was a little weird, but I like the rest of your teaching, so here's the rest of the money. I don't want to see you die. That's not what this is talking about, because that would be compulsion. That would be blackmail. God doesn't blackmail his people into giving. This is anyone who's willing. And yet it also says to take the offering, which is an action of force. So it's like, what? They have to bring it willingly, but I'm supposed to take it. What? It's mentioned three different times, like I said. And the rabbis, you know how rabbis are. They always find reasons for everything, right? There's reasons why it's mentioned three times. Here's what they explain. According to Talmud, in the book that I referenced before, Teruma, in that section, I don't have the exact reference, I should have, but I don't, that it's mentioned three times because there's three types of people that are going to give. There's the person who gives with an open hand. They're just automatically charitable. They see something. Oh, are you hungry? Here, let me give you something. Just because it's, yeah, she points at Craig. I love it because it's very true. My husband has a gift of mercy. He sees needs before people even will vocalize them, and he's running to meet the need. That's a gift in him that I love. I'm not sure I have the same gift, but that's okay, because then we can balance each other off. That way we still have food at our house too, right? Because he literally one time took the shoes off his feet. There's the one who gives with an open hand, just because it's part of the part of the nature, part of the gifting that God has given them to just be a giver. Then, the second time it's mentioned, it's to remind us of those who kind of drag their feet a little bit. That would be me. I wait until God moves. Because I know if I just gave to everybody, I'd have nothing left. And so there's a part of me that waits and says, God, am I supposed to give to this person or not? Sometimes I wait too long. I'll be honest. Sometimes God moves in my heart to do something and I kind of hesitate because, are you sure that's you, Lord? And then the moment's gone. Have you ever done that? Yeah. But there's this place where there's those of us who kind of wait. But when the Spirit moves us, when God speaks and he says, I want you to give, we give. Because the Spirit has moved us to give. Because we love him. Right? And then there's the third type of people who are also going to give to the building of the tabernacle. I love this. Don't blame me. I didn't write this. This is the great Rambam who said this. Those who are tight with money and physical possessions, who will not give until God forces them to do so. That is the man who leaves his coat behind at the restaurant. And someone else comes in who is cold, goes, oh, I need that. And they put it on and walk out. And the man who left it behind accidentally goes to look for it because it's his coat and it's not there. But God has taken it from him and given it to someone else. Okay? And I'm like, really? I mean, that's what's behind when I've dropped money accidentally? Then I've been too stubborn to do what I'm supposed to do, and so you just kind of take it from me, and oh, Lord, forgive me for being that kind of a person at times. Forgive me. Because I really don't want to be the one who's tight, who holds on to my things. Because they're my things. You know? You ever know someone like that? We can all get that way sometimes, and sometimes there's a reason for that. But at the same time, if God moves on you to give, that's when you're supposed to give. You don't wait for God to take it from you. But God uses all three people in this earth to get his will done and to bring his presence into this world. All three. And that's part of what they say is represented by the fact that it says, tell them to bring an offering, take an offering, and these are the offerings. It says it three times. To represent all three people. Went, oh, cool. God doesn't build his temple without everybody. Right. Why? Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. We sometimes forget that. He loves even those we don't love. He loves everyone. Everyone. He created each one of us, and he loves each one of us, and he desires each of us to be in his presence. Will we all get there? No, because there are some people who simply will turn their backs and become wicked and allow that wickedness in them to the point that God has to bring judgment. And there is a place where Scripture says he hates. He hates the one who brings that kind of iniquity. Why?
because they've turned their back on love. And they will not receive him. They will not. But here it says all three, people who give because they give, people who drag their feet and give when God says to, and people who would like to hold on to it but somehow can't because God takes it from them. And he uses all of them to build his temple. To build his temple. Verse 8, it says, have them make a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. Have them. It's an all-inclusive word. Build a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. There's a purpose to it. The purpose is his indwelling presence for each one, not just for the select few. It wasn't just for the sons of Aaron who could go in the inner court. His presence was there for all. It was there for everybody. Make it according to what I show you. You know, our spiritual need is for him to dwell with us. Anything short of that does not meet that hunger within us. There's someone who once said that everyone is born with a hole in their heart and only God can fill it. Many people try to fill that for many, many different ways. That's a lot of times where addictions come from. That's a lot of times where other things come in, where that person that holds on to all their things, it's partly because they're trying to fill that hole with things, with wealth, with power, with whatever. There's nothing in this world that's going to fill that hole except the presence of God. We all need the presence of God. Otherwise, we end up being kind of hollow. We can go about our days. We just keep going, you know, you put one foot in front of the other, and you just keep going. And I call that depression, when you just keep going because you keep going. But when the Spirit of God is there, gives you a purpose, a reason. The word tells us that we are to pray, to lift our, to open our mouths, to declare his praise. He inhabits the praises of his people. I mentioned that. But if it was just our praise and prayer alone that brought his presence, the rest of this wouldn't have needed to be built. He could have just said, stand here and pray and I'll bring my tabernacle. So those of us who love to come into his presence, who love to come into the house, who love to just pray, and just, that's great. But that's not all of the building of the temple. That's not all that needs to happen for his presence to dwell on this earth. Simon the righteous from the great assembly, that would have been about the time, that would have been the time of Ezra, setting up that great assembly to teach people how to be righteous as they were coming back from the first expulsion from Jerusalem. He said, on these three things the world stands. On the Torah, the Word of God. On service to God, Avodah. And on Gemilut Chasidim, acts of loving kindness. Okay? Torah, the Word of God. Avodah, service to God. And Gemilut Chasidim, acts of loving kindness. It's found in Avot 1-2, which is again part of the Mishnah. According to legend, and according to this understanding, and I think he's pretty right on, just as a chair requires at least three legs to function. Now, you can have a chair with four legs, or you can have a chair with three legs, and it'll work just fine as long as the legs are in the right place. If you don't have them spaced right, your chair's not going to stay well. Okay, so there's not just the fact that there have to be three legs, but they have to be spaced right. Okay. These are the pillars. Three legs will hold it up. These three things together are part of how God brings his kingdom or his presence into this earth. And each of these is talked about not just here in Torah, but also in the apostolic writings or the New Testament. We are told to study the scriptures. Okay? I know a lot of people that think that going to church on Sunday morning and listening to the preacher is studying the scriptures. I'm going to tell you that ain't it. It's not enough.
It's not what we are told to do. We are told to each of us get in here, dig in here, read it for ourselves, study it for ourselves, learn the meanings of the words if you don't know them, but put an effort into it. Don't just listen to someone else spoon feed you. Because if you're spoon fed, you're just a baby. Do we or do we not want to grow? Do we want his presence? His presence can't come among a people who don't know who he is. And how do we know who he is? Number one, through here. Number one, through here. In 2 Timothy 2:15, when I went to Bible college, I went to Bible college out of high school, by the way. I wasn't given a choice. I came home one afternoon and I'd about decided to start looking for work. My dad says, "Oh, by the way, you're registered for classes. Pack your bags. You're going to live in the dorm. Here's the I'm taking you there on Tuesday." Okay. I went to Bible college. I'd like to say I loved it, but I think they were happy when I left. Because I've always been one to ask questions and dig deeper and go, well, that's the surface. But there's got to be more to it than that. But anyway, the key verse of that Bible college, the one that they put up on the walls in every single room, 2 Timothy 2:15. I'm going to read it out of the Tree of Life version. "Make every effort to present yourself to God as tried and true, as an unashamed worker, cutting a straight path with the word of truth." See if I can remember it right from the memorization. "Study to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Study. Get in there and learn it. If someone comes to you with what looks to them like an obvious contradiction in Scripture, learn how to answer it, because there are no contradictions. God doesn't contradict himself. But sometimes if we read it a certain way, it looks like he does. Study it for yourself. Acts 17, 10 through 12. This is the Apostle Paul and Silas, who had been going from place to place to place, and they got kicked out of one place, and they went to another place called Berea. Have you ever gone to a Berean church, or have you ever seen that logo or that name, Berean? It comes from the concept of getting in and studying the Word. They might as well be Baptist in some ways. But anyway, it's that idea that to study the Word. Why? Because the people in the city of Berea did exactly that. It says in Acts 17, 10 through 12, "As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas to Berea. Upon arrival, they made their way to the Jewish synagogue." Every place they went, the first place they went was the synagogue. First place they went was the synagogue. Why? Because they were Jews. And Yeshua, Jesus, was a Jew. Yes. Who came for his people. And so Paul went to the Jews first, even though he was the apostle to the Gentiles. He still went to the Jews first. And it says, now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica. You see, they had just been kicked out of Thessalonica because the Jews there would not listen to them. In fact, the Jews there were trying to bring them before the city elders to be stoned. And instead, they got snuck out in the middle of the night. And they went to Berea. And it says, the ones in Berea were more noble-minded. Why? It says, because they received the message with goodwill, searching the scriptures each day to see whether these things were true. Paul didn't just go in there and say, "I met Jesus." Paul went in there and said, "I met the Messiah. Let me show you where he's at here." And he gave them scripture. And what scripture did they have? Torah. They did not have the apostolic writings. Matthew had not been written yet.
Nope.
The book of Matthew, by the way, was probably written after all of the Pauline epistles were done. Mark, Luke, John, though they hadn't been written yet. When they went out to the world, they went out with Torah and they taught Messiah. in Torah. So for those of you who tell you, those of you who've heard that the Torah was done away with because we have Jesus, Jesus never did away with that. He is in it all the way through it. Yeah. In every verse, in everything, there's a picture of Messiah. Absolutely. You can find him if you'll study it. If you don't want to study it, well, then, yeah, it is kind of hidden sometimes, and you might not recognize him because he's not a Greek. He's not an American. He's not what most of us think he should be, if we read it from our culture. He was a Jewish rabbi who was our Messiah, coming to be the king next time. He will come as king. Yes. But when he came the first time, he came as a suffering servant. It's part of why they didn't recognize him. But it's all in here. Be like the Bereans. Get in, dig in, study the word. Look to see what's real. It says, they searched the scriptures and says, therefore many of them believed, as well as quite a few prominent Greek women and men. So you see, he went to the Jews first, but guess what? There were people of the Gentiles who had already looked and seen that this God of Israel is somebody that's way different than what we've been worshiping. And they were learning. And they believed it too. So the first leg is Torah, the Word of God. Study the Word. Really short with the rest of this because we're basically out of time. Oh well. The second leg, Avodah, means service to God or service for God. One or the other, service to or service for, it means both. Service to God. We are called to love God, right? To love God with all our heart, with all your soul, with all your might. That's Torah. It's also what Yeshua said. Love God. When Jesus was being tempted in the wilderness, one of the things he did was answer every temptation with something that said, it is written, it is written, it is written, it is written. And he said, it is written, you shall worship Adonai your God, and him only shall you serve. Do not serve anyone but God. Serve God. That does not mean we are not of service to each other, because we are. But our service even to each other is serving God. Okay? Serve God. Do not serve others out of anything but love for God. That's the difference between works that are just dead works and works that are of the Spirit. Are we serving as if we are serving unto God, or are we just doing to be doing? That's one of the differences. In 1 Thessalonians, he talks to the church at Thessalonica, and he says, when he had been talking about them to the people in Rome, in Jerusalem, it says, they themselves bring news about what kind of welcome we had among you, how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. We are to serve the living and true God. We are to study his word, and we are to serve him. Sometimes that service takes the place of worship. Worship, praise, prayer. He inhabits the praises of his people. But if that's all we're doing, we're not serving God. That's just a part of it. That's just a part of it. If what we do here doesn't cause a change in here, if we're not getting closer to him, if we're not learning how to be more like what he wants us to be, then we're in trouble. The third leg, the acts of loving kindness, gemilut chasidim in the Hebrew. We're called to act with love and kindness towards each other, called to love one another. John 13, 34 and 35, I give you a new commandment that you love one another just as I have loved you, so you also must love one another. By this will all men know that you are my disciples. By the fact that you go to church. By the fact that you dress modestly. By the fact that you cleaned up your language a little bit. It doesn't say any of that, does it? Yep. It doesn't say anything about those things. It says, by the way you love one another. Do we love each other? I'm going to tell you something. There are some people that have come through these doors that I'm not sure I can love in my own power. But guess what? If we will take them to the throne of God, He will give us love for them.
Yes.
He does that. There are some people that I just don't like very much. Honest, you know, it took me years to find out there were people that didn't like me, and then more years to figure out that was okay. Not everybody has to like me. That's okay. And there are people who don't like me, and I know that. And I'm like, oh, well, I like what God's doing in me. I like God. I love God, and He's doing something in me, and so I like what He's doing. Does that mean I like every bit about me? No, I know my flaws way more than anybody else would know them. I'm more critical of myself than anyone else ever could be. But at the same time, I can love those people. May not like them a whole lot, but I can love. Why? Because love is an action.
Amen.
It's not just a feeling. If love were just a feeling, we'd all be in big trouble. But love is an action. It's an action. We act with love. The whole phrase, the gemilut chasidim, or the bestowal of kindness, the practice of chesed, is a benevolence that's greater than tzedakah. Now, tzedakah is giving an offering. Tzedakah is doing an offering for the poor. Basically, tzedakah is offering for the poor. It's that part that has gone to feed everybody that needs to be fed from our tables. On Shabbat evening, on Friday evenings, there's often a tzedakah box where before you begin, before you light the candles, you put your tithe in the tzedakah box. The tithe goes to feed the poor. Yeah, sometimes the poor are your preachers, but the tithe goes to feed the poor. That's what it's for. That's what it's designed to do. Okay? This teruma, by the way, the lift-up offering, that's designed to keep the temple functioning, that's 1/50. 1/50. That's not a whole lot, is it? I looked at that, I went, what? We've been taught 10%, right? No. This is the 1/50. This is different than the 10% tithe. The tithe was to feed the hungry. 1/50 was to be bring the offering in for the temple tax. About 2%. But we are called to act in love one for another. As He loved us, so we love them by action. Not just waiting for someone to say, I'm hungry, can you help me? The whole practice of Hesed, it says this, Zedekah awaits a cry of distress. Benevolence anticipates the cry of distress. In Psalm 89, 2 and 3, it says, I will sing of the love of Adonai forever. To all generations I will make known your faithfulness with my mouth. For I said, your loving kindness be built forever. The heavens, let your loving kindness be made firm there. So the heavens declare the loving kindness, the glory of God. And we talk about the heavens declare the glory of God. Well, the glory of God is His loving kindness. It's His looking at man and saying there was a need even before man ever cried out. And setting up something in place to take care of that need. And that's part of what we should be doing for each other. Seeing a need and meeting it without sitting there going, but they didn't call and ask. I have a friend whose husband is a pastor of a local church, and I love her to pieces. She's one of these people that just has this gift. She sees a need, boom, she's there. And someone, when they first moved here, someone from their congregation was going to have surgery, so she immediately started setting up that system of, you bring dinner this night, you bring dinner this, you know, who's going to bring dinner what night, because she knows this is going to be a need. The mother is having surgery. She's not going to be able to cook the meals. Someone needs to take care of this family. So she immediately started setting that up in a couple of places. But how do we know what food they like? We just buy them gift certificates to McDonald's and let them buy what they want. I'm serious. This is this really happened in this community. Because we are so afraid they might not like what I cook for them. Well, then ask them if they have any particular likes. Ask them if they have any allergies. Ask. But meet the need.
Yes.
I have an acquaintance, and I mean acquaintance, because I knew her years ago in a little Bible study I was part of, but we've kind of hit and missed and seen each other once in a while, who posted something on Facebook the other day asking if someone knew about a particular doctor in town. Well, I know the doctor, and I've worked with the doctor, and I understand. Anyway, I said, I know him. What do you need? Private message. She's going to be having surgery pretty soon. She's petrified. Why? Because it's surgery on the spine. That's scary. Why? Because one slip of the knife and you'll never walk again. And so she's asking about this particular orthopedic surgeon, and I started giving her some information that she's going to need. Oh, wow. And then I said, do you have someone who can meet you who will be at the hospital when you come out of surgery to sit with you to make sure you get your pain meds on time? Because they won't give you pain meds if you don't ask for them anymore. They're not allowed to by state law, by the way. If the patient doesn't say, can I have my pain meds now? They don't give them to you. And so patients who don't know that that's the case will sit and wait, and sometimes for hours, and never get their pain meds and wonder why they're in so much extreme pain. Well, I've learned a few things about how the hospital system works. And honestly, I think anybody who has major surgery should have somebody in the room with them for the first 24 hours Amen. To get things set up. I did that with you a little bit, huh? And your daughter-in-law came in and helped. And so I said, do you have someone who can be that? Because I'll be there for you if you want. And she was just in shock. Why? Because I saw a need and I offered to meet that need without asking. Without waiting for her to ask, because she doesn't even know she needs to ask. And that's part of this whole process. Sometimes people don't know they need to ask because they don't know what they need. But we are to meet the need. Walk in loving kindness. We owe no, Romans 13, 8 through 10 says, owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the Torah. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet any other commandment, they're summed up in this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fullness of Torah. And love goes beyond not doing harm. And love does good wherever possible. This is how the world will know that we are his believers. This is that third part of the ring. This is that third pillar that his presence depends upon. The word says, Exodus 25:2 says, take for me an offering. Teaching is this. If we will give, he will meet us. Take for him an offering, and he will come. It says, the Lord stands to the right of the needy. It's in Psalm 109, 30 and 31. Whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord. That's Proverbs 19, 17. It seems counterintuitive to carnal and worldly reasoning, but if we give to others, God gives us more in return. In Matthew, he says, bring the whole tithe unto me, and then there will be food in my house. To feed the poor, to feed, to eat. It says, and see if I will not open for you the windows of heaven so that no one is without enough. If we seek treasure for ourselves, it's not going to work. We may build up treasure for ourselves, but that treasure will go away. It will go away. If we build up treasure by giving, in terms of doing what God asks us to do, we are building up treasure that's a different kind of treasure. We are bringing his presence to us. Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, it will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And this is not talking about giving to the church. Okay, I am not telling you, oh, you have to bring your tithes. Make sure your 10% gets in the offering box out there. Yeah, there's an offering box there. Yes, we have expenses. Yes, it helps if you give. We need you to give so that we can meet those expenses. I would love to be able to get to the point where we're paying our rent at the level that the church that owns this building has to pay every month. because right now we're at half. We pay half. So that church is literally supporting us every month that we are here. But the reality is, if you see your brother in need out there on the street and you do not help them out there, what you give here is of no count. I'm just going to tell you that flat out. If you give so much to the church that you can't help your next door neighbor, that's not biblical. It's not. And we've had friends, and I love them dearly, who've listened to some of these preachers and have given everything into an offering for their church to the point that they couldn't pay their rent. Well, how does that look to your landlord?
Right.
You're a really good example of a Christian when you can't pay your own bills because you've given it to somebody else. God isn't asking for us to be stupid with our money. Now, if God moves on your heart and says give, then you better give. But don't do it out of compulsion. Don't do it out of the fact that some preacher says you have to. That's why we're supposed to study the word for ourselves, so we won't be manipulated that way.
Right.
Don't be manipulated. Give because God asks you to give. Do for your next door neighbor. Because when we do that, that is an act of service to God. See, that leg has two parts. It's like it's tied together. Like it's tied together. We study the word. That's one part of the leg. We serve God. That's the second leg. We give to others. That's the third leg. The Hebrew word mishkan comes from a root word which basically means to dwell. The tent, the compound, all of this is designed to be a place of sacrifice, a place of fellowship, a place where his presence can be manifested. But we have to do what he asks us to do before his presence can fill. We can't just sit here and sing, "Come Holy Spirit." Be nice if that's all it took. I've been in churches where they do that. And they get themselves worked up emotionally to where, and sometimes I'm standing in the back going, really? That's the presence of God? The presence of God that I've had has been powerful, has been strong, has been heavy, has been not just a feel-good thing. But for that to take place in his congregation, we need to study his word. We need to serve him in acts of worship, praise, and prayer, and participate in loving kindness. And when we build that kind of a temple, build that kind of a tabernacle, what does that stupid movie say? If you build it, they will come. If we build it, he will come. When we do these things, his presence in us gets stronger and stronger and stronger. Yeshua talked about a mustard seed of faith. If you have faith of a mustard seed, you can move that mountain. I'm going to tell you something about mustard seeds. If all you do is sit there and look at the mustard seed, if all you do is put it in a little necklace and wear it around your neck, and those are kind of cute. Actually, I gave one of those to someone once, and she just treasures it to this day. Because I was telling her faith needed to grow. Remember, you have faith. There's faith. But if we take that mustard seed and we plant it within the Word of God and we water it with our worship and our prayers and we nourish it, we put the fertilizer on it of our acts of loving kindness, guess what it's going to do? It's going to grow. Then we can move the mountains. Amen. Then we can move the mountains. And then the world will know who Jesus is. Now, I had a really weird thing that God said to do today. He does this to me all the time, right? How is the world going to know who Jesus is? By our love, right? By our walking together, working together. There's a song that was out in the 60s, I guess. They'll know we are Christians by our love, okay? Well, I have my guitar over here. And that's one of those few songs that I memorized. So I don't have to have the words because you don't have the words. But we're going to sing that song.
We are one in the Spirit. We are.
Dirty word to many people. Bad word because of what people have done in the name. But what it means is ambassador of Christ, Messiah. You are the little Messiah in this world. You're his ambassador. We are to be his love. We are to be his love. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for what you gave me. Thank you, Zeus. So clear, so concise in some things, and Lord, I appreciate that. Lord, I ask that you would bless this congregation. The Father, where there are needs that we see, that we will rush to meet those needs. Father, that we will have hearts of praise and prayer before you. And Father, that we will dig into the word and learn. Thank you for all you're doing in this house, in this place. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord and our Savior. Amen and amen. Moshe, do you know the Aaronic blessing?
Yes.
Can you do that for us today? Would you come up and do that?
Sure.
I so would appreciate that. I mean, I like ours, but that one's better.
Yivarekka Yehovah v'yishmarekka Da'eh havah paravir kovekuneka Yisaha Yehovah panav alekha V'yisev lekha Shalom
B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord
be gracious unto you and lift up his countenance upon you. Give you peace.
Amen. May it be sure how much you have. Amen.
Yes. Thank you.